hell about them. See, I'm not talking about getting on top of the mountain. I'm talking about speaking to the mountain. It once again, it makes no sense to your feelings or facts. It makes no sense to your feelings because you feel stupid. It makes no sense to the facts because the facts are the mountain is a stationary thing. It's really big. It's bigger than you. But faith says speak to it. Uh-oh. Faith says speak to that mountain of death. That's so big that you don't, ain't no way in the world you see you can get that thing removed. Faith says speak to that lump that you got in your body. Faith says speak to your children, you know, and speak faith to them in the name of Jesus. Faith says speak to the approval process for the air and the heat in the name of Jesus. Can I get an amen, somebody? Didn't say ask no more. We asked God about it. God spoke back to us, and his response was, amen, now speak to it. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Let's look at this. You say it. Well, Pastor, what you talking about? I don't show you the Bible. Don't believe me. Mark chapter 11, verse 23. For verily I say unto you that whosoever shall say unto this mountain. Somebody say, say. Did your Bible say say? You sure it didn't say ask? It didn't say to ask the mountain anything, did it? It said say it. Now, that's having God kind of faith. That's having faith in God. That's having the mind of God. Because God spoke to everything. When the mountains were created, God spoke to them. Amen. I mean, when he created heaven and earth, it doesn't the Bible say that everything was made by the word of God?
Yes.
I said, doesn't the Bible say that the worlds were made and framed by the word of God? Am I right about it?
Yes.
So God spoke everything into existence. He's used to speaking to stuff. Material thing. Actually, he's even deeper than that. See, he's not only used to speaking to what we would call inanimate things, material things. God is used to speaking to nothing and making something out of nothing. Come on, church. God is used to calling things into existence where there wasn't anything at all. So if he can call something into existence where there was no existence, what do you think he can do with something that is in existence? Are you heard what I said, huh, brother? If he can talk to something that does not exist and make it exist, well, what do you think he can do with something that does exist? If he can make stuff appear, you know, if God can make something appear, he can make it disappear.
Yes.
Am I right about it?
Yes.
If he can call, that's why I'm not worried about whether somebody after they die. That's why I'm not worried about what happens when they die and whether they are buried, burned, or in the ocean. Because when the time comes and the trumpet blows,
yeah, yeah,
and the voice of an archangel shouts, you know what I see there, Reverend? I see that the same God who said, Lazarus, come forth, and the body of Lazarus responded to the voice and the words of God. When God says, it's the rapture, come forth. Everybody, every molecule that ever was born again by the Spirit of God, they're going to, everything's going to start moving and coming together. And that body that belonged to that born again believer, I don't care if it was burned up, it's all of a sudden going to be the seed to a new body, and it's going to produce a new glorified body for the believer, and that body going to join with the Spirit, and it's going to forever be with the Lord. Somebody will say amen. But it's all because of the voice of God.
Yes.
When he commands, notice he said when the trumpet sounds, that's a shofar. That's that ram's horn trumpet. That's the sound that they would make before battle. That's the sound that they would make to gather the army, to gather the troops. And when that trumpet, that last trumpet sounds, God is coming and it's time. Listen, it ain't Scotty that's going to beam you up. Jesus, beam me up, Jesus. It's going to be Jesus and the rest of us. So we're going on up. Let's give God praise. We're going on up.
Come on up.
Verse 23, for verily I say unto you that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, that meaning a difficult, a large difficult situation. Did you notice that we have been talking about a victory, right? We have been talking about a victory and him cursing the victory with his words. Now Jesus said, I say to you, verily, truly, I say to you, whosoever shall say to this mountain. Wait a minute. I thought we were talking about victory. Jesus had changed the script on us. Well, Jesus, we were talking about it. Remember, we said, Jesus, you cursed the victory. And he's saying, in the same passage of scripture, whoever shall say to this mountain. Well, why did you leave the victory and go to the mountain? Because the mountain is even a greater demonstration of faith. Moving the mountain into the sea is even a greater demonstration of faith than causing the fig tree who had leaves on it to be cursed and dried up. What he was saying is that the same faith that caused the fig tree to change is the same faith that you use, the faith of God and the faith in God, to cause even a bigger, more difficult thing. So don't you get yourself all intimidated because you say, well, I was able to speak to that situation and pay my last month's rent, but now I'm talking about a debt that I can't even imagine getting out of. Somebody say it's the same faith. You speak to that too. Whoever shall say to this mountain, be thou removed. Say, be removed. See, be removed. That's not a request, that's a command. That's not an asking. That's not a request. It's a command. It's faith. It's boldness. It's confidence. Where? In yourself? No, in God. In who he is, what he said, and what he can do. Be removed. Death, be removed. Sickness, be removed. Depression, be removed. Drama in my house, be removed. Drama at my job, be removed. You know, if somebody's messing with you, be removed. Listen, because God is saying, I have given you power. I've given you authority. I have the authority of God. Say it, I have the authority of God. He said, be removed and be cast into the sea. Again, factually, you say, how can that happen? Factually, that's no, you haven't seen it happen. But that's the thing about God. Just because you've never seen it happen before doesn't mean it can't happen. Because nobody had ever seen a woman born of a holy seed before doesn't mean it can't happen. Amen? Never seen it before, but it doesn't mean it can't happen. You know, just because they've never seen a man raised from the dead, what? Doesn't mean it can't happen. So he says, be removed and be cast into the sea. He commanded it. Letter D says, don't doubt. Letter D says, don't doubt. A said, have the faith of God. B says, have faith in the power of God. And C says, speak with the authority of God. Speak as God speaks. Speak with confidence. Speak with authority. You know, I think one of the biggest things that we have to do in the church, and I can't wait till I get a series to do this, is we're going to have to see ourselves as who God said we were, and that is soldiers in the army of the Lord. Yes. Soldiers have a military mindset. Not only do they give commands, but they submit to authority. Now, I know every time Pastor talk about authority, people start getting nervous in the sermon. Oh, lie, you're talking about authority. Talk about submission. Yeah, I am talking about it because that's the language God talks. Yeah. And the sooner we start getting that language, sir, yes, sir. The sooner we start getting, when you get that attitude, and if you get the attitude, he says it many times. He said, endure all hardness as a what? As a good soldier. And then he said, watch this. He said, every day you should put on the whole what? Armor of God. You don't want to think like a soldier, but then the devil going to take your lunch every day. You don't want to think like a soldier. You're not going to, see, you got to think like a soldier. You got to understand what a soldier thinks like. That's why when the man came to Jesus and he said, please heal my servant. And he said, you don't even have to go to my house. Just send the word. You know what he was really saying when he said send the word? He was saying, give the command. And Jesus looked at him and said, brother, I like the way you think it. He said, I haven't seen greater faith like this, not only among my people of Israel. Wow. He said, you're a Gentile, but I understand something, and that is you understand faith, but faith and authority. authority go hand in hand. Faith and command go hand in hand. Faith and ordering people underneath you go hand in hand. He said, you understand that, so therefore I can honor your faith. And we have to start thinking like that. We have to start thinking militarily. We have to start thinking like soldiers, because that's who we are. We stay under authority, and then we are given authority. We stay under authority. We don't move unless we hear what to do. We don't just go out half-cocked and without orders. But once we have some orders, we don't ask the enemy nothing. We execute orders. We command. We come fully packed, fully loaded. We come ready to kick some butt. Are y'all hearing me today? Amen. Amen. We don't come playing around. We come locked and loaded. We come ready to go. Now watch this. Letter D says, don't doubt. That's exactly where I wanted to go. Don't doubt. Say, don't doubt.
Don't doubt.
Because what you speak, now this is important. This is really important. I don't know if anyone, when I heard teaching about Mark 11:24 years ago, I never felt that I was hearing the total picture of what needed to be said. And it's kind of like how I feel about these gospel tracts. You know, I saw people with gospel tracts, and I never quite felt it was the right thing. So then I came up with my own. So this teaching right here is very important to me, because I always heard people talking about this thing, but I never really heard people explaining it in the way I think is right. And I think this is what's right. Don't doubt, because what you speak is the will of God. Now that's why you don't doubt.
Wow.
You don't doubt when you know that it's what God said. You don't doubt when you know it's God's will. I'm going to tell you something. One of the greatest things you could ever do is, I always told you that to be in the will of God is the most successful place to be. But one of the greatest things you could ever do is to know God's voice, and to know that when you hear his voice, it's his will. And church, I'm telling you, if you give me just two or three people who are adamant about the will of God, we can take this city. If you give me just a few people who just, all I need is somebody to say, I don't really care. I just know that's what God said, I'm doing it. Or I don't get that. God didn't say that, I ain't doing it. But when you can know that it is the will of God, then you can be really adamant about what you're saying. Here's what I'm talking about. Jesus only spoke the will of God.
Yes, he did.
He only spoke the will of God. That's why every time he prayed, every time he said something, he said it with authority. In fact, do you recall what the people said when he first came on the scene? They said, we've never heard any teaching on this wise. They said, because he speaks with authority. Now, part of that was how he was talking, but the other part is what he was doing in conjunction with what he was talking. In other words, he talked, and then after that, he confirmed his words with what? Signs following. In other words, they said, we've never seen it on this wise. We've never seen where the people were actually talking. Like the scripture says, the kingdom of God, 1 Corinthians 4:20, is not in word, but in power. The kingdom of God is not in word. In other words, it's one thing to say something. It's another thing, you know, it's one thing to say that we we're going to transform this place into a fellowship hall. It's one thing to say that we're going to get a flat screen up here. We're going to have movie night, Christian movie night. It's another thing to see the power of God move this thing, and you got the proof that's in the pudding and the tasting. Amen, somebody. People, listen, Jesus only spoke the will of the Father. So therefore, because he knew that everything that he was saying was the will of the Father, therefore, he was confident when he said it.
Yeah.
Is this making sense to anybody?
Yeah.
If you start with the premise that Jesus only spoke the will of the Father, now it stands to reason why he talked like he did. He would just say, be healed, be removed. He, you know, by two words, boom, boom, just bang. And the thing about it is, notice when tempted with the devil in the wilderness, same thing. He would always come back with the word, because he always was speaking what the will of the Father was. So he was never nervous in the service. He was never not bold. He was always sure. Now let's look at this. I gave this to you on Sunday, but we're going to look back at the scripture again. John chapter 12, verse 49. John 12:49. It says, John 12:49 says, Jesus is in red. Jesus said, for I have not spoken of myself. Look at that. See that? I have not spoken of myself. What's the number one thing we need to do if we are Christians, Christ-like ones? We need to develop what he just said. Where when we speak, we have not spoken of ourselves. In other words, we need to give up. I told you that humility was the key to success. Amen. When we submit our will to his will and our thinking to his thinking, and we can say, I have not spoken of myself, then that means that what's getting ready to come out of my mouth right now came from the throne room, and it's going to have power because it's got the backing of God. Yes. If I stop trying to say what I think and what I feel, I told you feelings and facts. If I get that out of the way and I say, you know what, this is what God would want me to say in this situation. Whether it's, I forgive you, I love you, you know, whatever the situation is, irrespective of the facts, irrespective of the feelings. You know, there's sometimes when people will do things to you and you either want to say something bad or you don't want to say anything at all because, you know, they say if you can't say something good, don't say anything at all. But God will tell you to say something good. And if you say something good, it's the will of the Father, and it's going to bring power. It's going to bring power. So he says, I have not spoken of myself, but the Father which sent me, he gave me a commandment what I should say and what I should speak. Whoa. And the Father which sent me, he gave me a commandment. Uh-oh. Did you see that? Jesus is saying, not only do I say what the Father says, but the Father commanded me to say it. So really, you have to be kind of rebellious. You have to be rebellious not to say what the Father says, because the Father don't command you what to say. The Father now is commanding us as to what to say, because he's going to speak it through the Holy Spirit. This is all we're talking about, spirit-led. The Father's going to tell you what to say, and if you don't say it, you are rebellious. See, that's why faith is so important. Because I've learned to say things even when I was afraid of how people were going to take it or were they going to leave the church or whatever. But see, when you speak the truth in love, that's just obedience. Right. Amen? You just being obedient to the Father. And faith brings the reward. Amen? Do you know how deep this is? This scripture right here, John 12:49, which says, I have not spoken of myself, but the Father which sent me, he gave me the commandment what I should say and what I should speak. It reminds me of another scripture in Ephesians 4:30, which it says, let no corrupt communication come out of your mouth. Now, listen to me very carefully. When you hear that, that's an absolute. It's saying, let no corrupt communication come out of your mouth. You know what that means? That means, and then it says, but minister grace unto the hearer. In other words, every time you speak, it should be speaking life and not death. Now, it may scare some of us because we're going, well, God knows my heart. He knows I'm not perfect. I mean, I be saying some stuff, and I have to admit. And you know what? That's right. But what God is saying to us is, it's time to set your sights. You know, we're not perfect, but it's time to set your sights on perfection, if you want to say it like that. Because he said, let no corrupt communication come out of your mouth, but only that which ministers grace unto the hearer, edifying the body. So, in essence, it's a step-by-step process where you got to stop being negative. It's a step-by-step process where you got to start. If you haven't yet trained your mind and trained your mouth to say the right thing, then don't say anything until you can get there. Start speaking less. If you